Hachette Audio presents All Dogs Go to Kevin. Everything Three Dogs Taught Me That I Didn't Learn in Veterinary School. Written and read by Dr. Jessica Vogelsang. Dedication. To the misfits, the miscreants, the misunderstood, the freaks and geeks and socially inept, and the dogs who love them. Preface. It took me a moment to realize that the choking intake of air I was hearing was the sound of my husband crying. It was an unfamiliar sound. In 10 years of marriage, I had never encountered it. Silently, I watched the spreading pool dampen his pillow until it almost matched my own. Brian thought I had fallen asleep, but how could I? Hours earlier, his best friend, Kevin, had died. After they said goodbye to Kevin in the ICU, his friends and family gathered at his favorite Mexican joint to pour a margarita in his honor and share some of their favorite memories. There were plenty to choose from. You had to hand it to the guy for managing to pour a whole lot of living into 40 short, occasionally debauched years. They smiled as they told the one about the silver flute, the one about the pirate ship, and the one about the time Blue Oyster Cult showed up at their house. Then, as the adrenaline wore off and the reality of the day set in, they all wandered home, where spouses like me asked them uselessly what we could do. "I'm okay," Brian said, faking a tired smile. "I'm all right." "Do you want to talk?" I asked. "No." I wouldn't have known what to say anyway. Brian sat on the couch and flipped on the Discovery Channel, rubbing his temples. When I went to bed, he stayed put while I pulled the covers up to my chin and stared at the ceiling. Eventually, he slid in beside me and put his head down. I opened my eyes and stared at his back, my hand hovering as I debated whether to put it on his shoulder. But before I could decide, I heard an old familiar sound approaching from the hallway. Thump, thump, thump. The approaching sound of my black lab Kikoa and her bullwhip tail. She paused only long enough to sniff the ground and make sure there were no loose crumbs on the floor before making a beeline for my husband's side of the bed. She slid her face along the edge of the mattress and rested her nose next to Brian's, her tongue snaking out to kiss him on the nose. Only then, in that quiet moment in a pitch black room, was he finally able to let the loss sink in. I brought my hand back down to my side and closed my eyes, trying not to let my sniffle give me away, and went back to sleep. Kikoa had this one. Dog the First, Taffy. The spirit of enlightenment first shone upon me in a pile of incandescent dog poop. I had spent most of the afternoon angrily lecturing my Lhasa Apso Taffy for destroying my newly purchased 64-pack of Crayolas. Bonafide wax junkie, Taffy was unable to resist the temptation and destroyed half the contents while I was at school learning whatever it is third graders learn. I came home to find paper shavings and crayon nubs strewn about my bedroom and one satisfied-looking dog with green teeth. "I wanted those crayons," I said to her. "I needed those crayons." Taffy licked her lips, unimpressed. Bits of wax stuck in her beard like confetti. By the time I finished picking wrapper remnants out of the carpet, Taffy was prancing back and forth in her interpretive "I have to potty" dance. I leashed her up for a walk, grumbling as she merrily pulled me along. Halfway up the street, we ran into old Mr. Rillsworth, standing at the end of his driveway with his arms folded across his chest. He peered down his long nose at me. "Are you the child whose dog is relieving itself in my driveway?" he asked in a sonorous voice. "No," I lied. I don't know what it was about the Rillsworth driveway, a simple concrete affair much like every other one along the street, but Taffy saw it as irresistible, a throne fit for a queen. I did my best to be a responsible child by picking up after her almost every time, but sometimes I just forgot. Mr. Rillsworth pushed the sleeves of his cardigan up over his forearms and pursed his lips, unconvinced. Someone, he huffed, has been leaving piles of dog refuse at the end of my driveway. And this morning I stepped in one. He rubbed the sole of his loafer on the concrete in distaste. That is unacceptable. Yes, sir, but it wasn't me, sir. My palms were sweating. He looked like the type who might pull a switch out of the garage. We were at a standoff. His Siamese cat watched us silently from the window, licking her front paw. I was weighing the pros and cons of framing my sister when Taffy took matters into her own hands. While I was defending my dubious honor, the ingested crayons had been snaking their way through Taffy's digestive tract. Bored with the conversation, Taffy chose that moment to prove her guilt and hunched over in the same place Mr. Rillsworth had been pointing to in his driveway. As he grimaced in disgust and my mouth fell open, Taffy produced a veritable work of art, a multi-hued cone of glory. It looked like a small, tie-dyed ski hat. I took advantage of the old man's shock to yank a bag out of my waistband and quickly scoop up the trophy. "See, sir?" I held my hand out, driving him back 3 feet toward his door. "It wasn't us. My dog poops rainbows." Before he could retort, we scampered away, earlier events forgiven. From that point on, Taffy and I were a team. Some of us are born knowing just what to say to impress other people, to claim the world as the oyster we so richly deserve. The rest of us have dogs. Unless you're my friend Kevin, of course, but that's a story for a little later. Chapter 1. You'd think someone as antisocial as I am would have been surrounded by animals from an early age, but I was a latecomer to the realization that I was an animal person, because with the exception of my grandmother, nobody in my family actually liked animals. From the time I was born, I was known as the sensitive one in the family. I spent a lot of time crying. Singing "Rock-a-bye Baby" was banned when I was 2. Once my mother finally figured out the imagery of an infant crashing through the tree limbs was sending me into hysterics. Shortly after that, I announced I was never watching Tom and Jerry again because I felt sorry for the cat who was just trying to get something to eat. Other cartoon bands soon followed: Roadrunner, then Sylvester and Tweety. Exasperated with all these failed attempts to keep me entertained in front of the TV, my mother eventually led me to the children's section of the library and told me to read whatever I wanted, which suited me just fine. When I was 4, my favorite place to hang out and collect my thoughts was under the kitchen sink, where I would curl up next to the Windex in complete darkness and ponder the mysteries of the universe. My mother would find me and tell me that the neighbor's kids were outside if I wanted to join them, and I would reply, "No thanks." When I got too big for the kitchen cabinet, I found my way into the cool cellar, flipping through our stacks of musty old National Geographic magazines, reading about Jane Goodall, and dreaming of a life in the jungle amongst the chimps. Instead of grounding me when I was in trouble, Mom would kick me out of the house and refuse to let me back in until dinner. "Go play," she'd implore, closing the door, then locking it behind her. I'd sigh, then wander across the yard to my grandparents' house, where my grandfather was on permanent vigil in the foyer, reading history books. We would sit side by side for hours, reading. Then I would come back home and pretend I had been riding my bike all afternoon. It wasn't that I disliked all the other kids in the neighborhood. It's just that I preferred books to people. They were easier to put away when you were done. My mother was flummoxed at this development, having raised in my older sister, Chris, an archetypal extrovert who talked from sunrise to sunset. She tried multiple approaches to bring me out of my shell, with little success, as the options in a dying mill town in early 1980s Massachusetts were pretty limited. Gymnastics was an utter disaster, ending with me on the floor in the fetal position with a bruised nose on my first day. Dance was only slightly better, though I was always in the back row during the recitals, behind the willowy girls with the swingy ponytails and impeccable rhythm. There's no joy in repeated attempts to squish yourself into a mold that you know deep in your heart is not one you are meant to fill. I soon learned that the less I drew any sort of attention to myself, the less anyone would think to ask me to do something I hated. Team sports, Girl Scouts, couldn't handle the door-to-door cookie sales. Lest you think I was unhappy scurrying around the margins of society quiet as a mouse, I can assure you every day I evaded the notice of my fellow man was a victory. Another day in my.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.